Next on Gardener's Hotline, we'll learn about growing pomegranate trees. Don't go away.
The studios on the Daytona State College East Campus.
Hi, I'm Karen Stoudeman, a University of Florida Horticulture Extension agent and your host for Gardener's Hotline. Today we'll be talking about pomegranates, which are native to Persia and Asia. The Spanish brought them to the New World in the 1500s and California in the 1600s. A little later, they arrived in Spanish Florida. The word pomegranate comes from the Latin meaning apple of many seeds. The most popular variety in nurseries today is called Wonderful. However, many new varieties are available today. The pomegranate has never been as popular in the United States as in other countries because people think it's hard to eat. But now that pomegranate juice is gaining fame for its health benefits, it's becoming popular. Today's guest is the expert in pomegranate trees and other fruiting trees. Please welcome Dr. Bill Castle, Professor Emeritus from the University of Florida at the Citrus Research and Education Center in Lake Alfred. Welcome to the show, Dr. Castle.
Hi, Karen. Glad to be here tonight. Thank you for inviting me and providing this opportunity to talk a little bit about pomegranates.
Well, tell me, how did you get interested in pomegranates?
Well, the real interest begins with the citrus industry and the greening disease that's having such a disastrous effect on the industry. That has raised an opportunity and interest in alternative crops. And so there's a lot of conversation out there about pomegranates and other crops as alternatives to citrus.
Wow. Well, you know, this is so interesting. I'd like to invite our viewers at home, now's your chance, to ask Dr. Castle a question. And the number to call in is 1-800-901-9238. Well, tell me a little bit about what you do there at the Citrus Research and Education Center in Lake Alfred.
Well, I'm still engaged with my old buddies working with citrus a little bit, but 3 years ago we started a project with pomegranates, primarily to collect pomegranates because there are such a diversity of pomegranates out there, propagate them and get them out in the hands of people who can help us do an evaluation. So that's the primary purpose of the project.
So we're at our infancy stage, right?
Very much so.
So we're behind. Which states are leading us in this?
The only state really that produces pomegranates on a commercial basis is California. They have something like 35,000 acres out there. And
wow.
They produce the wonderful variety that you mentioned in the introduction.
Now, how many acres do you think we have here in Florida?
Right now, none.
Oh, my goodness. Well, that's a prime opportunity to be growing these, isn't it?
Yes, very much so.
Now, can we grow these in our backyard?
Very much so. There are three, maybe four options available for growing with pomegranates. One certainly is to grow them on a commercial scale, which is what we're really exploring. And ornamentals are certainly another opportunity, and they're very well suited, I would say, to an edible landscape.
Are they hard to grow?
No, they're actually very easy to grow. They propagate as cuttings, and they do that easily, and they grow almost pest-free, you might say. There's not too much that bothers them. And they happen to be cold hardier than citrus.
Oh my gosh, but why wasn't this discovered earlier?
Well, that's a good question, and I'm not sure what the answer is to that question.
Well, let's take a look at some of the pictures that you brought in of what pomegranates look like in our dooryard.
Okay. On the screen now, on the upper left-hand side, is the black pomegranate. It looks like a small, round eggplant. It's rather intriguing simply because of its color, because most pomegranates, as illustrated in the lower right-hand corner, are red, maybe a few yellow in color. And then there are many ornamental types. One in particular that's illustrated here also in the pots is available in a variety of stores around Florida, and that's a dwarf ornamental variety that's very well suited to the homeowner and to be grown in a small container.
How tall will that dwarf get?
Well, we have an illustration here that we'll look at later, and it'll probably get maybe 4 or 5 feet tall.
Oh, that's adorable.
This is simply an illustration of the parts of the flower and the parts of the fruit, and also recognition of the fact that one of the fruits of antiquity, along with figs, dates, and olives, is the pomegranate, which means that they've been grown and eaten for maybe several thousand years.
Wow, such a long time.
And to illustrate the fact that we can grow them in Florida, this is a two-year-old tree of a particular variety called Afghanski that's growing in central Florida. And you can see it has quite a nice crop of fruit on it. And that particular tree is being grown in the tree form. You'll notice there's only a single trunk there. This is an illustration of the other way that pomegranates can be grown. In fact, this is actually the more natural way that pomegranates grow. That's sort of a shrub with multiple stumps, and that happens to be a very, very good illustration of that particular procedure. Now, one of the interesting aspects about the pomegranate is that it has two flowers. The large flower on the right is a perfect flower. That means it has male and female parts to it, and that is the flower that actually produces the edible fruit. The smaller flower on the left is a flower that has only male parts, and it basically drops off of the plant as the female and perfect flower continues its development.
Is this insect pollinated or is it wind pollinated?
It's both, but you'll certainly see bees flying around in there helping themselves to whatever they find there.
Another wildlife plant we all like.
Sometimes there's confusion about what the edible part of the fruit is, so this picture sort of illustrates the fact that the large edible part of the fruit is actually a seed, and it happens to have a fleshy seed coat that is called the aril, and that's the part that has the color and the juice and the flavor. So that's the edible portion of the fruit. And of course, the other important part of this is that some seeds are soft and are easily eaten, some are medium, and some are very hard. Now, one of the varieties that looks most promising here in Florida is one called Azadi. It's a large yellow fruit with a soft seed and very excellent flavor. And the bottom photograph illustrates what the fruit looks like and the color of the seeds as it's grown in California. And the upper left-hand photograph is of the same variety being grown again in central Florida at about 2 years of age.
That grows pretty big for 2 years of age.
Yes, we're not sure how large they'll get, but that's a question that gets asked all the time, is how big are the trees going to get? We don't know that yet. We haven't had enough experience. Also, it's very important to recognize that among the edible varieties are many ornamental varieties that would be very suitable for a landscape, not an edible landscape. But some of these varieties have edible fruit on them and some do not. But this certainly illustrates the fact that there are varieties with flowers other than just red or orange colored flowers.
That's stunning. Now, so will that produce a fruit?
Some of them will and some of them will not. And if anyone is interested in additional information, we have a website that's located at the Citrus Research and Education Center, and that is where there's a great deal of information about a whole variety of factors and information related to pomegranates. So anyone's welcome, of course, to visit that site.
Lots of information.
Yes.
That's wonderful. Well, tell me a little bit more about, you have brought a tree in here. There's no thorns, so that's a nice thing. What time of year do they produce the fruit? What months?
Well, many people ask questions about how to grow these, and oftentimes with the absence of good information about that, I simply say grow it as if it was an orange tree.
Okay.
It flowers in the springtime. Now, this particular dwarf variety is a very good potted plant, and it flowers and produces small fruit virtually all year round. But the ones that are being grown for commercial purposes, they have larger leaves, nice dark green leaves. They flower in the springtime, and as we mentioned earlier, the fruit generally is mature in late August or September.
So they're just in time for Thanksgiving, or a little before that?
A little bit before that, yes. That'd be right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now this is a dwarf, so you obviously have larger trees. How fast do they grow each year? How many feet can one grow?
Well, the plants that we have in Central Florida that were illustrated a moment ago grew to 6 to 8 feet in height in 2 years' time.
Wow, that's an awfully fast rate.
So we'll see how large they get.
But now, you showed us a tree form and a free form shrub. Which do you like the best and why?
Well,
or does it matter?
I'd like to make a confession at this point in time. I began thinking that the tree form was the best form and it would be more citrus-like and that you could put a wrap around the tree and protect it from herbicides and so forth and so on. But I have subsequently learned and changed my mind about that, that probably the free form or the more shrubby type is the better one because it supports the fruiting branches better and thus the fruit. So I think that's a much better approach.
Wow. And does that have any effect on the yield?
Well, I've been told that the Californians use that routinely because it begins to bear earlier and produces more fruit.
Wow.
So those are all good reasons. And many plants, in fact, in California are put on a trellis to help support the branches. So that's very interesting.
Now, how would you propagate one of these?
Well,
are they propagated by the seed or by cuttings or
they can
grafted?
Be propagated both ways, by seed and by cutting. But as with seeds in many cases and with pomegranates, you're not quite sure what you're going to get if you reproduce the plant by seed. Cuttings is the way to go, and in this case, it's absolutely the way to go because they root so easily and almost any time of year, so why not do it that way?
Right.
Then you're guaranteed you've got the same plant again.
Right. Well, we've got a caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Dr. Castle?
Yes, it's about avocado trees.
Okay.
And what it is I've started the avocado tree, and I've got it going real well. And I've had it in one pot, and I've changed it to a larger pot. Okay. Now, how large should I let this plant get? It's about a foot to a foot and a half high now. And it's leafing out just great. But how should I prepare the ground and what should I do to put it into the ground?
Well, that's a very good question. And I think the first thing that comes to mind is if you're trying to grow a pomegranate plant from seed and you've taken the seed from an avocado, you've taken the seed from an avocado fruit and have germinated that and grown that up, then you're going to encounter a difficulty with the juvenile period of the plant, how long it will grow before it begins to produce flowers. And with avocado, that can be a very long time. The very best thing for you to do is to take that plant that you have now, if it began from seed, plant it, grow it up to a certain size, and then go find a variety of avocado that you really like and graft it to that plant.
That's a good point. That's wonderful. We have another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Okay, I have a question about citrus. I recently bought last summer three citrus plants, grapefruit, a tangelo, and a Weyer's lemon. Okay. The tangelo and the grapefruit I put in the ground, and during the summer, last summer was pretty hot, but anyway, both of those trees did not do well. I used garden soil. I watered them. The Myers I put in the pot on the patio, and it's still in the pot. And that one seems like the healthier of the bunch. The tangelo tree died. The grapefruit tree is on its way. I did water them. I noticed that the tangelo and the grapefruit developed like spots on the leaves.
What would you recommend he do with that?
Well, a couple of important issues that might explain, for example, why any of those plants would have done well in a pot as opposed to the soil is that I'm assuming that all of those plants were reproduced on a rootstock, and each rootstock doesn't do equally well in different kinds of soil. Almost all of them will do well in a fertile mixture like a peat mix that goes into a pot. But depending upon what the soil is like in this gentleman's yard, those plants may or may not do very well, or they'll take a little while longer to get adapted to that environment and to grow, even with good irrigation and good fertilization.
That's a good tip. We have one more caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the show. What's your question for Dr. Castle? Go ahead, caller. What's your question for Dr. Castle?
Yeah, my question is, I have a pomegranate tree, and last season it bare pomegranate, but the pomegranate all gets spotted black. What should I treat this tree with to get a nice fruit?
Well, There are a few problems with pomegranates that we're just beginning to identify. Now, there is one problem, a fungus disease that attacks the leaves. It causes little brown spots on the leaves. The name of the fungus is Cercospora. It's easily treated with a copper application, but there is another fungus that attacks the fruit and can cause fruit rot on it, beginning at the blossom end of the fruit and working its way into the fruit. That is a tough character that we're just learning about, and we're not sure how to treat that at this point in time. Most people who have a tree growing in their yard, it gets large enough, it produces a lot of fruit, and you simply have to live with the good fruit that remain on the plant for the time being.
Now, Dr. Kelso, how far north would pomegranates grow, and how far south?
Pomegranates are quite cold hardy, as I said earlier, so there's a bit of a pomegranate industry, if you will, certainly a homeowner industry in Georgia. The free form that we looked at a moment ago was of a plant growing in South Carolina. So they certainly will grow all the way up into the southeastern states, Georgia, South Carolina, maybe even North Carolina, and they will certainly grow almost all the way throughout Florida.
Well, that's a wide range. And with all those health benefits and the omega-3s, it's no wonder we don't have more of them.
Well, they certainly have a lot of appeal. And when people ask about marketing them, if I'm going to grow a commercial enterprise of pomegranates and I'm going to market, how do I do that? And I think the first part of the answer to that question is, well, gosh, everybody kind of already knows about pomegranates and the health benefits and so forth, so they sort of market themselves. So what we're really trying to establish is that there are so many different ones that we should be taking a look at increasing the range of the season by having this one and that one that mature differently and so forth. So there's a lot of opportunities with it, and it's a healthy fruit.
Yes.
It's a healthy fruit.
Why don't you show us how to open a pomegranate? I'm dying to see this.
Okay. Well, if you look online on the internet for the means of extracting the seeds of the fruit, there are a lot. A common one is open the fruit and place it underwater and loose them and they all float. But I've tried that and I'm not convinced yet that that works. But one way to do it this is the blossom end of the fruit, is simply slice off the lower end of the fruit, and already we can see something that looks very exciting.
Look
and has
how rich
color.
That red color is.
Yes, but let me remind everyone in the audience tonight that this is a California-grown pomegranate, not a Florida-grown pomegranate.
And what would it look like in Florida? Do you know?
Well, we're working on that.
Okay.
Yeah, there's quite a range in color, I'd say. And then simply score the fruit in a few places.
Okay, you're going about a quarter of an inch deep.
Just to basically work our way through the peel. And by doing so, we sort of loosen up the sections of the fruit. And when we're finished with that, this is a little bit messy, but that's a fairly easy way to break the fruit apart.
Wow.
And see the reason why people get excited about the mystery of a pomegranate fruit, because all you see is this sort of innocuous sort of thing. But inside, whoa.
Yes.
Inside is something exciting.
And it's so clean.
So it's pretty easy to just simply
and you can eat it whole. You don't have to take any
That's
and blend
right.
it or get rid of the seeds, because this
right.
is a soft-seeded variety?
I don't actually know.
It's not.
Okay.
Which means the seeds are a little bit firm, just a little bit, but they do make soft varieties.
Okay, now this is an experiment we're going to do next.
Okay.
We also removed the blossom end of the fruit.
So that was one way. You're just showing us another way to cut it?
Yes.
How do you know when the fruit is ripe?
Oh, fair question. If we take one of these larger fruit and take a look at that, you'll notice that the fruit is not actually round, that it appears to have some flat sides to it. That's a real serious indicator that the fruit is mature.
So you just go out and pick them at that point?
When they reach this stage, they're definitely mature.
How long will they keep on the counter, or do you have to put them in the refrigerator after you pick them?
They have quite a long post-harvest life, I would say.
What's long?
Maybe weeks.
Oh, wow.
At least. Yes, after they've been harvested. Yes, they're very, very, very easy to store. Well, so we cut off the blossom end. We do the same thing again.
And while you're cutting that, I want to take a caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Dr. Castle tonight?
Yes. Hold on. I'll turn the TV down. We planted some Texas field peas this past year, and none of them blossomed. They didn't get any, we didn't get any fruit, you know, any peas at all. What would have caused that?
This is a pomegranate plant, and I'm assuming that it is a cutting and not a seedling. The situation with pomegranate seedlings is the same as is with the avocado and any other plant generally from seed. It may take several years longer before it begins to produce any fruit, particularly if it's in the first stages of growth.
Oh, so you're gambling when it's a seed. And these are the seeds you can actually plant?
Yes, you can actually plant those.
Okay.
Okay. Well, so we've not taken the top off the fruit, and we've just sort of scored it and loosened it up a little bit. And this is the experimental part of what we're going to do now. I've seen this happen, but if you sort of open the fruit like that and...
Oh, they fall right out.
Beat on it a little bit.
Now, are they juicing inside?
No. No, they're just freeing themselves up and falling out. And there are some other devices that it can use that are a bit more sophisticated than this device is.
Yeah.
And you just keep beating on the fruit like that, and out they fall.
Now, how do you get the juice out of these? Or is it at a processing center that they do that?
Well, there are machines that one can purchase, countertop machines, that can be used just like with oranges to juice them. But I'm not familiar with any manual procedure that you would use to juice the fruit.
We've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight?
Hi. I wanted to find out about the soil. We have sandy soil and a mucky soil. And I was just wondering which one it would be better to plant it in. Would the pomegranates plant better, grow better in the sand or in the muck?
Good question.
Well, that is a good question. Pomegranates do not do well in wet situations, particularly chronically wet situations. So drainage is very critical. The plants that we looked at earlier this evening are being grown in the central Florida on the deep sandy soil. We have some plants being grown in heavier soils with more organic material in them. So actually the answer to the question is amend the sand with a little bit of the muck and use that, because pomegranate plants respond very well to organic enrichment of a sandy type soil.
And I've seen these grow in Daytona Beach, so they can get sandy in saline, can't they?
Yes, they do apparently tolerate saline conditions rather nicely.
Let's take another quick call. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Dr. Castle?
Hello.
Hi. Go ahead with your question.
Yeah, my question is, I have a pomegranate plant. I planted from the seed. This is 6 years ago. I finally really excited to get the tree full of flower, blooming beautiful, and I joined it before the summer. And then about September, and they have like 50 pomegranate on my tree. I was so excited. But then by the time I think the pomegranate probably is good, they all turn black. What did I do wrong?
Unfortunately, because of the environment that we have in Florida, which is hot, humid summers, we have more problems with fungal diseases than where they are normally grown, like in a Mediterranean climate such as California or in the native areas for the plant. There is a disorder of pomegranates called black heart, and there's a particular fungus that you wouldn't realize has invaded the fruit, that when you open it up, that's when you would see that there is some disturbance of fungal infection on the inside. I suspect that's probably what's going on with the fruit.
So what could she do? Could she pick it earlier, or once you get it, you can't rectify it?
Chances are that if you looked at the fruit in August, that it actually would be edible and very nice. So you're right, Karen. Getting a jump on this disease would be one way to approach it. Otherwise, I would encourage some searching on the internet for answers to that question.
Wow, that's great. Now, how about fertilizing? How often do you fertilize it, or you recommend homeowners do that?
The plants that we are growing in our evaluation sites are being fertilized with something akin to 909 fertilizer or 828, something of that nature, about once a month. And I think it's very important to realize that the pomegranate plant appears to be very sensitive to fertilizer, which is a good thing in this case, because it means if the leaves are getting a little light colored, it's time to fertilize them. If they're a nice green color like they are in this plant, they're happy little campers right then.
Wow, that's a great indicator too, even for most plants. Well, we're out of time, and I'd like to thank my guest, Dr. Castle, and thank all of you in tuning in today's program. If you'd like more information on pomegranates, or if you have any further questions, please feel free to email us at wdsctv@daytonastate.edu. I'll see you next time on another edition of Gardener's Hotline. So long.